In this video, I will be breaking down the comic book story of Geiger Volume 1. This was probably one of the most exciting new comics in 2021. It is written by Geoff Johns and art by Gary Frank. And Gary Frank, he is an amazing artist, so we are in for a treat with that. Now, Geoff Johns is one of the writers I associate most with DC Comics. He has been at DC for like 20 years or so, and he has written some of the best runs on various characters, whether it be Aquaman, The Flash, Hawkman, Superman, as well as his decade-long run on Green Lantern. Probably one of the best Green Lantern runs, no, not probably, definitely one of the best Green Lantern runs ever. He completely revitalized the character and pretty much invented a lot of the Green Lantern mythos, especially with regards to the other Lantern Corps, like the Yellow Lanterns and Red Lanterns and whatnot. That was all Geoff. And Geoff was so big at DC, he was eventually promoted to being their chief creative officer in 2010, and he held that position until 2018. So he was kind of the guy spearheading the creative vision for DC over those years. But he has finally left that position, and this is the first time in a long time that he has wrote a comic not at DC. He has started his own creator-owned book over at Image Comics called Geiger. And it is very exciting to see Geoff finally do something not connected to DC, getting to create his own superhero-connected world. And this Geiger Volume 1 book is just the beginning. In 2022, there's going to be a lot more stories set in the world of Geiger. So this is a very interesting, exciting project to see, you know, how good will Geoff be with his own thing. So I'm very excited to go over this story with you. Let's dive into Geiger Volume 1. Issue 1. Welcome to Fabulous Las Vegas. The story opens and we see two men in hazmat suits in the Las Vegas desert. The one man has an eye patch. We are not told what year it is, but from clues in the story, we can eventually figure out it is sometime after the year 2050. It might be 2055 or 2060 or 2070, not sure, but it is at least after 2050. The two men discuss various events. They make mention to something called the Unknown War, which happened in the year 2030. And then they talk about a man that had many nicknames: Joe Glow, the Man of Mass Destruction, the Walking Bomb, the Meltdown Man, the Glowing Man, etc. The man with the eye patch. He knows the story of the Glowing Man, and he is going to tell it. So that is our sort of framing device, and then we jump back to the year 2030, when this unknown war supposedly started. After months of global violence, a whole bunch of nuclear bombs were about to go off, and we see a man named Tariq Geiger. Tariq realizes that the nukes will be exploding any minute, and he needs to get his family and himself into a nearby fallout shelter. Tariq yells for his wife, Tracy, to gather the kids and get into the nearby shelter. They eventually all make their way into the shelter, and we see the nuke is flying up in the air above. And Tariq's dog, Molly, is outside the shelter and is barking at the bomb. So Tariq, he leaves his family in the shelter to run back out and try and grab the dog, Molly, and get back in before it's too late. As Tariq leaves the shelter, though, he gets shot in the leg. His neighbors are coming, and they announce that they're taking the shelter for themselves. Tariq yells for his wife to shut the shelter door. He says, "Do it now!" Tracy is apprehensive, but she does it. She tells her husband that she loves him. Tariq, he says he loves her back. It is just Tariq, his dog Molly, and the two neighbors outside the shelter. And the nuke explodes, and we see a huge mushroom cloud erupt over the desert. We jump ahead 20 years from that point to the year 2050. The world now is somewhat of a post-apocalyptic wasteland. If humans go outside, they usually wear hazmat suits to protect themselves from radiation. Humans can still live indoors without hazmat suits, but proper technology has to be in place to filter the air. We see three men in hazmat suits. They are scavengers looking for riches out here in the desert. They come across the very same bunker that Tariq Geiger had his family run into 20 years earlier. A makeshift wall has been built of garbage and scrap metal surrounding the bunker, attempting to hide it. The three men go up to the bunker door and start trying to pry it open. That is when Tariq Geiger reveals himself and tells the men that they are trespassing. Geiger, he has been alive these past 20 years. Somehow, he survived in this nuclear wasteland, and he does not require a hazmat suit like everyone else. Geiger has devoted himself for these past 20 years to guarding his family that resides inside the bunker and ensuring their survival and trying to stop any threats that may try and disturb them. The scavengers attempt to shoot at Geiger. He dodges their bullets and attacks them, kicking one in the face and punching another. Geiger, he then removes these two rods from his back. And when he does that, he starts to get all glowy from the radiation emanating from his body. He then repeats to the men that he said, "No trespassing." He manages to make the scavengers run away scared. With that confrontation now over, Geiger is ready to settle in for the night. Geiger's two-headed pet wolf, Barney, comes over to Geiger, and the two of them retreat into Geiger's home. Geiger's home has many books, although he wishes he had more to read, as he's read them all many times by now. And this is basically how Geiger lives his life. He protects his family, and then he goes into this house here, he eats beans, he reads, and he's generally alone with his dog, and he marks the days on the wall. We jump elsewhere to the city of Las Vegas. Las Vegas is now ruled by many eccentric and colorful bosses, each with their own territory occupying a particular hotel and casino. There is Nero, Safari Bob, Milky Way, Goldbeard, Bonnie Borden, and the King. The King, he occupies a hotel and casino called the Camelot. If you've ever been to Las Vegas, there's a casino called the Excalibur, which I assume is roughly what the Camelot is supposed to be. So this King of Las Vegas, he is a young man who has recently taken over the Camelot after the death of his father. The King, he is pompous, narcissistic, and very full of himself. He is having a mural painted of himself riding a dragon, and he is telling the painter that his shoulders need to be painted broader. The King, he also hates his mother, who he refers to as the Beast, although everyone else officially refers to her as the Queen. Now, those scavengers that encountered Geiger earlier, when they ran away scared, they reported their confrontation to the King, because they were working on behalf of the King. And this Geiger, this glowing man, he is now somewhat infamous in Las Vegas. His reputation is growing. People just hear rumors of the scary glowing man out there in the desert, and they fear it. The King is now talking to one of his men named Warhead. Warhead is a buff man with a mohawk haircut. He seems almost like a mercenary. The King, he wants to find out more about this glowing man out in the desert that scared off his scavengers. The King says that he wants to see this glowing man for himself and hunt him. The King tells Warhead to gather the nuclear knights. Warhead tells the King it's too dangerous for him to tag along. The King, he then starts throwing a fit and he yells at Warhead and he says, "This is his opportunity to finally slay something. Oh, what fun it will be." The king, he then walks to his balcony overlooking the city of Las Vegas and he proclaims, "This is my chance for glory." Issue 2, The King and I, and Issue 3, Fallout. Over these next two issues, the comic kind of tells the story a little bit out of order and jumps around, but I am instead going to explain the story to you all in a more chronological way. So first, let's begin with the origin of Tariq Geiger, how he survived and how he became the Glowing Man. Tariq Geiger, when he was alive, before the Unknown War, before the nukes fell, he was diagnosed with cancer. In order to stay alive, he participated in some sort of radical experimental cancer treatment. And when the nukes went off during the Unknown War, something about the radiation from the nukes and Tariq's experimental cancer treatment allowed him to survive and made him into this powerful, glowing man. Tariq Geiger was unstable, though. He would erupt into violence and energy outbursts. But with the help of a doctor named Dr. Molotov, Tariq was given some rods made of boron that will help stabilize Tariq's internal temperature and keep his energy dampened and stop him from glowing. Tariq now keeps these rods on him at all times in his back, and pulls them out only when he wants to start glowing and attack something. From then on, Tariq spent the next 20 years protecting his family. Now, let's jump over to the King and his nuclear knights and their confrontation with the Glowing Man out in the desert. So the King of Las Vegas and his nuclear knights headed out into the Vegas desert to search for this glowing man that scared off the king's scavengers a day earlier. Geiger, with his two-headed pet wolf Barney, is sitting in a chair outside the bunker his family resides in. Geiger touches the bunker wall and tells his children inside to sleep. As Geiger returns to his cabin, inside are some of the king's nuclear knights. They have guns and were hiding, and they begin shooting at Geiger. Geiger runs and avoids their gunfire. He jumps through a window in his home and gets back outside. But then he is hit with a big booming explosion. Geiger gets knocked out for a bit, but when he eventually comes through, he is being held by many of those nuclear knights. We see the nuclear knights all have hazmat suits on, sort of combined with knight's gear. Eventually, the King of Las Vegas, in a gold-plated knight hazmat outfit, fit with a crown, walks over to Geiger. The king is unimpressed with the man. He was expecting something more intimidating. The king says to his knights, "You have to be joking. This is the horrible, glowing man who's been attacking my scavengers? The one everyone in Vegas has nightmares about?" The king pulls his sword and tells his knights to hold Geiger down and keep his neck long. The king wants to behead Geiger himself, although the king admits it might take him a few swings to slice through his head properly. Before the king can decapitate Geiger, though, he notices the bunker, and the king wonders what's inside. Geiger yells for the king to stay away from there. Geiger, he wants to protect his family that resides inside. The king, seeing this reaction from Geiger, is now very intrigued. He tells his men to blow open the doors. The nuclear knights attach some explosives to the door of the bunker and blow it open. Geiger, he is concerned for the life of his wife and kids. Are they still alive in there? Will the king kill them? The truth is, they are already dead. They died a long time ago. When the nukes went off, the bunker must not have been able to protect them from the radiation. So they've been dead for many, many years, maybe immediately when the bombs hit. Geiger, this whole time, He's just been hoping they were alive in there, and he has been protecting them for all these years, hoping what he was doing had purpose. But it was for naught. One of the nuclear knights, looking inside the bunker, says, "There is nothing inside, nothing worth anything, just a bunch of skeletons." The king, he puts it all together, and he figures out that the glowing man must have been protecting this bunker the whole time. And the king starts laughing, that pompous, rich, spoiled jerk kind of laugh. The king says, "But you've been protecting a grave? you poor idiot. The horrible glowing man, what a fool you are." Geiger, really riled up now, he reaches those rods in his back and he removes them. And by doing that, he is able to make his body glow and heat up. And he makes the chains strapped around his wrists burn off. The knights, they begin firing on him, but it is of no use. Geiger hits the men, and his pet wolf, Barney, attacks some of the knights. Geiger, he grabs a handgun one of the knights had and shoots one of the other knights in the head. He then sword battles some of the others. Eventually, Geiger and the king himself start sword battling. The king is a weakling, though, and Geiger, he just melts the king's sword with his glowing hands. Eventually, Geiger also melts through the king's hazmat suit, specifically the part protecting the king's face. Now, moving away from this confrontation in the desert, I want to explain something called the nuclear football. Before we continue on in the story, I need to explain what it is. So, the nuclear football is a real thing. Ever since John F. Kennedy was president in the 1960s during the Cold War, the president has had a military aide carry around this leather briefcase. And inside the briefcase contains a system for identifying the president. And along with it, there is also the president's launch codes, which he usually keeps on his person. With the nuclear football, the president is able to communicate with the National Military Command Center in the Pentagon, which monitors worldwide nuclear threats. And through this, the president can order a nuclear response. This briefcase was nicknamed the nuclear football. And every president since JFK has had a military aide with this football travel with them wherever they go. Now, in the world of Geiger, at some point, the president's plane, Air Force One, crash landed. And when the plane crashed, scavengers searched the plane and managed to find and fight over and eventually retrieve this nuclear football. It was presumed missing for years in the wasteland. Most people had no idea what happened to it. But the reason that this nuclear football is valuable is because it contains the sites of every nuclear warhead in America and may potentially allow whoever has it to launch any nukes that may be left. The people that scavenged this nuclear football were a group called the Organ People. So these Organ People have the nuclear football. And these Organ People are pretty messed up. They are a group of people that refused to wear hazmat suits in the nuclear fallout, so their body is now riddled with tumors, and they kind of look like sick mutants. And in order to survive, they spend their time hunting for innocent people, which they call donors. They hunt these people so they can steal their organs and have their surgeons stitch the new organs inside them, buying them some more time. They also sometimes eat the remaining unused organs. So these Organ People, they have this nuclear football, which they scavenged from Air Force One. But they never really realized how valuable it was to some people. So that is the story of the nuclear football. Eventually, a man and woman on a motorcycle that did know how valuable that nuclear football was made a deal with the Organ People. They traded a human heart to them in exchange for that football. And now we see that man and woman on a motorcycle in hazmat suits with a little sack inside of which contains the nuclear football. They are planning on selling it to the king of Las Vegas so they can become rich. They travel into Las Vegas. They have to go through some sort of radiation decontamination cleansing. And once they are through that, they are then inside the Camelot Hotel and Casino, and they are free to remove their hazmat suits. Now, it has been several days, perhaps a week or two or three, since the king and his nuclear knights had their confrontation with Geiger in the desert. Now we see at the Camelot, a mural of the king has been repainted, now showing the king's heroic battle against the glowing man. And the story being told about the king and his confrontation with the glowing man is pretty much made up and a complete exaggeration and fabrication of the events that actually transpired. A bartender showcasing the mural to some customers explains, "The king's men returned from Boulder City, terrified by their encounter with the glowing man. So the king led a crusade to face the creature, and our courageous leader fought valiantly, saving his nuclear knights from the monster's burning clutches. And the king banished the radioactive horror from the land, vowing to pierce his dark heart if he ever returned." The truth is that the king had his ass handed to him by Geiger. The man and woman with the nuclear football are dressed really fancy. The man is in a tux, and the woman is in a sparkling dress. They walk through the casino, and they ask to speak to a man named Hazmat. We see this Hazmat. He is a nuclear knight of the king's, and he is a very boisterous man, very muscular. He is sporting a mustache. He is playing craps right now in the casino. The man and woman with the football wish to speak to Hazmat. They tell him that in their possession they have the nuclear football. They got it out in the wastes. They traded with the Organ People for it. The Organ People had no idea what they had. Hazmat tells one of his colleagues, Warhead, to call down the technicians to verify this thing is real. Over the years, so many people have tried to pass off fake nuclear footballs to the king, so Hazmat, right now, he's being a little dismissive about what these people claim they have. A barmaid in the casino named Carolina is in that bar, and she sees this whole conversation go down between Hazmat and this man and woman. Carolina is a poor woman, working hard to make a living for her family. Back home, she has a 15-year-old daughter named Haley and a little boy named Henry. Carolina is standing there, and she sees this purple sack that contains this nuclear football. She knows it is valuable because she has overheard the king and his people talking about this thing for many years, trying to find it. Carolina sees how Hazmat is not paying much attention to the sack. She decides to take it, steal it from right under Hazmat while he is distracted playing craps. This could be her ticket out of here. Carolina, she grabs it and she walks off. Carolina then heads home very quickly to her two kids, Haley and Henry. Carolina has the nuclear football. She tells her children then that this sack is their ticket out of here, to safety, to freedom. She explains to her daughter Haley, the older one, that in this sack is a relic from before the unknown war. It's called the nuclear football, and the king has been after it for years. She tells them that they have to leave right now. They are going to go to NORAD, otherwise known as the North American Aerospace Defense Command. NORAD is the only place left where the American government still has control, and this nuclear football will be the way they buy their way in, and there they will be safe. Carolina shows her daughter Haley on a map how they will get there, and she says that they need to leave right now. They need to get to the car, get in their suits, and go. That is when Hazmat kicks down her door along with a bunch of his nuclear knights. Hazmat, he knows that she stole the sack with the football from him. They have cameras all over that place. They saw her take it. He demands that she give it back. Carolina plays dumb, and Hazmat stabs her in her chest, killing her. Haley and Henry, they then start running off with the football. They run down the hall to an elevator. They manage to get the door to close and they ride it down to the garage. Haley and Henry then get into their hazmat suits. They then get into a car and they drive. And they manage to get away before Hazmat can catch up to them. The two of them are now driving out in the desert. Both of them are crying. Their mom is dead now. A gigantic radioactive insect hits their windshield and cracks it. This causes Haley to crash the car. Haley and Henry grab the football and crawl out of the car and attempt to run away. The giant radioactive insects chase after them. Eventually, Geiger's pet wolf Barney saves the kids and attacks the insects and rips them in half. Geiger, he also arrives and smashes some of the bugs as well. Back in Camelot, Hazmat and Warhead are kneeling and reporting into the king their failure in losing the nuclear football to some children. They say they will get it back, and the king, angry, says, "I want my holy grail," referring to the football. The king then says, "It's out there, where he is, and I can't face him alone. I can barely face anyone after what the glowing man did to me out there." And we see the king's face is all disfigured and grotesque after his last confrontation with the glowing man. The king, he managed to escape with his life, but now he is very ugly with tumors and scars all over his face. The king yells, "Bring me my mask!" The king, he then travels to the Manhattan Casino and Hotel, where he meets with another boss in the city. Her name is Bonnie Borden. She is dressed like a sophisticated 1920s flapper woman, with a short skirt, a feather in her hair, and a long cigarette in her hand. The king wishes to make a deal with this Bonnie Borden. Out there in the desert, Geiger introduces himself to the kids. He tells them that the giant insects they saw were called Nightcrawlers. Geiger tells the kids that they need to go. Some soldiers might be on their way here soon. The kids should be gone before they arrive. He tells the kids to just get back in their car and return to Vegas. Haley explains that they can't. Their mom was trying to get them someplace safe, and the king's men killed her. Now Geiger, he had a confrontation with the king and his knights recently, so he knows how dangerous they can potentially be, especially to two kids. Eventually, a few of the king's knights arrive. They get out of a car and see Geiger and the kids, and they say, "Oh, look what we got here. These two thieves and the glowing man himself. You all got quite a price on your heads. Let's collect it, boys." Geiger, he decides to help protect these children. He removes the rods from his back, and he blasts his energy at the knights, exploding their car and easily killing them. Geiger, he then tells the kids, "You said your mom was trying to get you someplace safe? Let me see that map you were talking about." Geiger, he decides then he is going to help these kids get to NORAD, to safety. Issue 4, The Organ People. At the Camelot Hotel, the king goes to see his mother. Others refer to his mother as the queen, but the king hates his mother and refers to her as the beast. So we see the queen, or the beast, is a grotesque, overweight woman, forced to live in squalor by her son in the basement of the hotel. The king tells his mother he may soon have the nuclear football. He asks where are the nuclear launch codes that father hid. If she tells him, he promises to bring her back upstairs. The king's mother laughs at her son and says, "You ugly little scab! Look at what the glowing man did to you!" The king, he lets some light into the room, which seems to hurt the mother, and he asks her again for the codes, forcefully. The queen replies, "Close that right now, Jeremy!" So we just learned that the king's real name is Jeremy. Elsewhere at Goldbeard's casino, we see Goldbeard talking to Miss Borden. Both of them are bosses in Las Vegas. They have a discussion about the internal politics at play. They discuss potentially helping the king retrieve the nuclear football. They could lend the king some of their army to help him track it down. And if the king does find it, then they're going to want to be on his good side. And maybe they will get some missiles of their own in return to play with. Goldbeard asks Miss Borden, "And what about Safari Bob? What's he gonna say about us going behind his back?" Safari Bob is some other boss in Vegas. Miss Borden replies, "Who's gonna tell him? Come on, Goldbeard, gather your pirates." So for now, they are going to help the king retrieve the football. In the desert, Geiger with his two-headed wolf Barney drives the kids and takes them to a hotel for the night so they can sleep. The hotel has some sort of filtration system, so the kids can remove their hazmat masks for a little bit. The kids in the hotel room eat some food, and then they all sleep for the night. In the morning, they continue their drive to NORAD. On the drive, they get attacked by some of the organ people. I briefly mentioned the organ people earlier, but they are people that don't wear hazmat suits, and because of that, they are all mutated-looking, and they require fresh organs to survive. Well, now we get some Mad Max Fury Road action going on. As they're all driving in the desert, and the organ people are in their vehicles, and they are trying to run Geiger and the kids off the road. The organ people are pursuing in a motorcycle, an ambulance, a burger truck, and a yellow Jeep. The organ people attempt to punch through the windshield of Geiger's car, but Geiger punches them, and then Barney the Wolf bites some of the organ people. More organ people are jumping in on the action. They climb on the car while Geiger continues driving. Geiger yells for Haley to grab the wheel and drive while he fights these people off. Geiger, he kicks their car door off, and then he climbs on the roof. He removes the rods from his back, and he gets all glowy. One of the organ people attempt to stab Geiger in his head, but glowy Geiger just melts their knife. Geiger, he hits some of the attackers off their car, and he eventually jumps off the car that he is on and onto the yellow Jeep that some of the organ people are driving. Geiger makes the yellow Jeep flip over and crash. Haley and Henry in the car decide to stop it and look for Geiger and see if he is okay. Haley, she eventually gets out of the car and starts walking down the street. One of the organ people, still alive, grabs her leg and Haley screams. She's frightened. But eventually, that attacker gets shot in the head. Who shot him? Well, in the distance, we see some US soldiers from NORAD with guns up on a cliff. A person in a yellow hazmat suit asks the kids, "Howdy, miss, you lost?" Issue 5, God Bless America. Haley and Henry are talking to the NORAD soldiers. The soldiers say that they are the good guys. The kids give over the nuclear football to the soldiers, and the soldiers are aware of its importance. They are going to get the kids back to their base. The kids say that they got a friend down there, referring to Geiger. The soldiers, they knock Geiger out, and they bring him to their base as well. We see in the desert the King, Goldbeard, and Miss Borden all in their suits are driving in pursuit of the nuclear football that the kids stole. They come across some beat-up organ people, one of which has a third eye in the middle of his forehead. The King tries to beat information out of the man, but it is of no use. They do find a map on him, though, the one that the kids had, and that map will lead the King and his men right where he wants to go. Haley, Henry, and Geiger are brought inside the NORAD military base. Inside, we see the Vice President of the United States. We also see the woman that was in the yellow hazmat suit, and she removes her mask and reveals her shaved head and gnarly scar on her face. We do not learn this woman's name, but she is referred to as the General. The General and the Vice President discuss the nuclear football. The VP says, "With this, we can now isolate the silos that have remained hidden and take back control of our nuclear arsenal." The General replies, "The South, the Great Lakes, they'll have no choice but to unite under President Griffin again." So from this, we're not exactly clear how the political situation in America is going. It seems like America has splintered a bit. There's various groups in various areas of the country. And there is a President Griffin, although it seems like not everyone is following him. The General discusses the children that they found out there in the desert that they brought in, and how they will be tested to see if they are in good health. She also discusses Geiger, and how they're not quite sure what the deal with him is, and the scientists are looking into it. We see Haley and Henry are being walked through the base. There are actually other children in this base, even a school and learning going on. One of the children Haley and Henry meet is named Rick. Rick, a young boy with glasses, introduces himself to Haley and Henry. Elsewhere in the facility, Geiger is being inspected by some scientists. The scientists are puzzled how Geiger seems in perfectly good health, despite breathing outside. But then they see a tube in his back, and they get kind of curious and remove it. And that was a mistake. When the tube is removed from Geiger's back, he wakes up and gets all glowy, and then he breaks free from the chains he was in. He then escapes from the room he was locked in. Geiger, outside the room he was in, sees a guard reading a book. The guard, he cowers and is scared of Geiger. Geiger, who was an avid reader but lacking new books a few weeks back, is interested in what book the guard was reading. The guard was reading a book called The Artist's Way. Geiger asks the guard, "That a good book?" The guard says, "I like it." Geiger, he knocks out that guard and grabs that book. He then continues walking through the facility with his wolf, Barney, and he is now looking for Haley and Henry. Haley and Henry are being tested to see if they are healthy. They are also given lots of food to eat. Delicious food that was pretty hard to come by back home in Vegas. You know, they're eating hamburgers and fries. Little Henry is loving it. The doctors and others, though, looking at Henry through a two-way mirror, discuss his health. Haley, the girl, she's healthy, but Henry apparently has early-stage leukemia. One of the women that works there is kind of sad by this news, as this means Henry will not be allowed to stay with them here, as that is their policy. They only have so many resources, they can't waste them on the sick, like Henry. Haley is eventually told the news that she is healthy and can stay, but her brother Henry is sick, and he will not be allowed to stay. Haley is upset. They try and comfort her and tell her that they have a compassionate life-ending program here and Henry will pass peacefully. Haley can't believe this. She storms out of the room and is running and yelling and saying, "No, Henry!" As Haley is running frantically, she gets grabbed by a guard, and the guard gets bitten by Geiger's wolf Barney. Geiger then finds Haley, Haley informs Geiger that they said Henry was sick and they're gonna kill him. Geiger angrily says that won't happen. Elsewhere in the facility, the vice president and the general are coordinating with the president to find and locate those nuclear silos. The vice president discusses Geiger. Geiger has been causing havoc in their facility. He's dangerous and violent and been tearing up the place. The VP says, "We don't tolerate violence here. It's been a while, but send our best soldier to take care of this. Bring the robot online." So who is their best soldier? Well, we see some sort of nuclear-powered thing is being placed into what looks like a robot. And we see a uniform with the name Joe written on it. We will learn who this mysterious Joe soldier is next issue. Issue 6, Man vs. Machine. This is the final issue in Volume 1 of Geiger. Back in Issue 1, many years in the future, we had a man in a hazmat suit with an eye patch talking to another man, telling that man the story of Geiger. That was kind of the framing device for telling us, the reader, the comic book story of Geiger. Well, we return to those two men right now, and the eye patch man is going to continue the story, but first, he is going to give the other man, and us, the reader, an information dump on the timeline of this Geiger comic book world and the various superpowered people that encompass this universe. Writer Geoff Johns clearly has big ambitions for this world that go far beyond just Geiger's story. He is planting seeds for the scope of this whole connected universe, and the timeline is also pretty vast. So the man with the eye patch, he says, "America has always been at war, and in every war, there are men and women rising up to fight for their freedom and their family. Some of these heroes are known, but some of them aren't. They call them the unnamed." And then he talks about various points in American history, which we can see explained in this nifty timeline breakdown, which was at the end of Issue 6. I am not fully sure what Geoff Johns' plans are for the future, but he may be doing tons of little miniseries on each of these characters and time periods. So, during the American Revolution in 1776, there was a hero named Redcoat. During the American Civil War in 1864, there was someone called the Northerner. During World War II in 1944, there was someone called the Monster. During the Vietnam War in 1972, there was someone called Junkyard Joe. In 1997, there was someone called American Widow X. That is when she got her revenge. Revenge from who, for what? Who knows? In 2025, there was something called the Unseen War. That is when the powered person known as the Ghost came about. 2030 marked the beginning of the Unknown War, when the nukes fell, and that is when Geiger became the Glowing Man. And 2050, which is when the majority of the events of this comic book took place, is when Geiger met the King and Henry and Haley. Anyway, after teasing all of this Geiger-connected universe, we continue on with the story. Henry, he is eating some ice cream, not knowing anything is wrong. Eventually, Geiger and Haley burst into the room and tell Henry what is happening, and that they have to leave right now. Henry is scared. Geiger hugs him and tells him that he is not going to let anything bad happen to him. Some soldiers come in to attack at that moment, but Barney and Geiger take them down. Eventually, that little boy Rick with the glasses, whom we met last issue, tells Haley that he can help them find a way out of here. Rick leads them to a hangar, and he gives Haley and Henry hazmat suits, which they will need on the outside. He tells them that they can escape this way. There may be some soldiers in their way though, but if they get past them, they'll be fine. Haley asks, why is he helping them? And Rick answers, I don't know. We don't all like the rules here, you know? Geiger, he heads into the hangar, but when he does, Geiger gets whacked back. That is when he comes face to face with Junkyard Joe. Junkyard Joe appears to be a robot in some sort of military uniform. From the timeline, we learned that Junkyard Joe came about during the Vietnam War in 1972, and the vice president ordered him to be brought back online last issue to deal with Geiger. So he must have been taken offline for a certain number of years. Geoff Johns has also announced a Junkyard Joe solo comic coming out in 2022, and that book will showcase Junkyard Joe's origins. So anyway, Junkyard Joe and Geiger start fighting it out. Geiger attempts to whack Joe with his rod, but Joe just crushes the rod in his hand and punches Geiger with his other hand. Geiger grabs Joe's helmet and melts it, but Junkyard Joe just whacks Geiger with such force that Geiger flies across the hangar and into a flammable tanker, causing a huge explosion, opening a path to outside the hangar to the radiated world. Joe and Geiger continue fighting now outside. Henry and Haley, they see Geiger's dampening rod in the ground, stuck there, and they want to get it for him. They go over to the rod and they start pulling on it, but they can't get it out. Rick, the kid with the glasses, he joins them and offers to help them remove the rod from the ground. Haley, she's concerned though. Rick's eye looks damaged and he's not wearing a hazmat suit. He might get sick out here. But Rick, he helps them anyway, and the three of them successfully remove the rod from the ground. Haley and Henry then try to run the rod over to Geiger. Junkyard Joe, he shoots some missiles from his arms at the kids. The explosion sends the kids flying back. Watching the fight through a video screen are the vice president and the general. The vice president, talking about Junkyard Joe, says, you know, I've never seen it active before. Are the stories about his creator true? And the general answers, Joe's been reprogrammed to do what needs to be done, Mr. Vice President. Every last one of them. Geiger, he manages to grab the rod that the kids got for him. He then jumps up in the air with the rod and stabs Junkyard Joe in the chest with it. Joe falls down to his knees. He starts powering down. Before he does, though, the robot sees a memory of an old man, and the old man asks Joe, Joe, is that really you? Joe powers down. What does that mean? This image or memory must be a tease of something that will be explained in future stories. Geiger, he attempts to retrieve the rod from Junkyard Joe's chest, but the rod is broken now. Haley and Henry get closer to Geiger. Both of Geiger's dampening rods are destroyed now, and Geiger is worried he won't be able to control his powers and might kill Haley and Henry accidentally because of it. Geiger, he yells at the kids to stay back. Stay away from him. He tells them to go. He can't control this. Haley, she starts crying, and she tells Geiger, Tariq, listen to me. You won't hurt us. We're like family now. And Geiger, somehow, without his rods, is able to regulate his body and lower his powers and become less dangerous right now. All three of them hug. Haley says, we're here for you, too. Rick, watching from a distance, smiles at them making it out alive. Barney the Wolf joins Geiger and the kids. Rick yells for Haley and waves at her. Haley asks him, Christ, Rick, what are you still doing out here? Some soldiers at that moment come and take Rick away. The soldier says to another, his mother is going to kill us. This kind of exposure? Ugh. Let's get him in before the general has our asses. So, what is up with this Rick kid? Why was he so determined to help Haley, Henry, and Geiger? And why did the radiation not seem to be affecting him as much as the others? I have no idea. I assume an answer will be revealed in the future. Geiger and the kids finally leave the facility and begin driving away from the NORAD base. But they are not free. The King is there, along with Hazmat and his nuclear knights, as well as Goldbeard and a few other reinforcements. Geiger, he gets out of the car and starts walking towards them. The King, a little bit nervous, sends his main man Hazmat in a car to go and attack Geiger straight on. The King explains, "Hazmat, I appoint you the nuclear knight to fight for my glory." Hazmat, not really wanting to do this, says, "But you can drive if you want." The King says, "I'm not the driver, you are my honored knight. Now take charge of this warship behind us." Hazmat, he starts driving full speed at Geiger, and the King yells, "For the Camelot, for me, destroy the glowing man." And destroy the glowing man, Hazmat did not do. Geiger, he easily made the car explode into two pieces before it even gets close to him. And Hazmat died in the blast. Goldbeard, seeing that crazy shit go down, says, "He glows all right. Well, I think my time with you is over, King. Miss Borden, are you going to be leaving with us?" And she is. Goldbeard and Miss Borden abandon this mission to help the King. They are going to go back home. Geiger, he heads back to his car and drives with the kids. He tells them that they're going to go to a town with doctors. One of them helped him a long time ago. They don't like him very much, but they'll help Henry now. The King, watching Geiger drive away, is even more infuriated now at this recently failed attempt at killing the glowing man. He is just not willing to let this go. He wishes to call for all of his nuclear knights for one last confrontation. 3 days later, Geiger drives to Copper Canyon, Mexico with the kids. This must be the town that he talked about. A woman at the gate of the town is named Nurse Red, and she tells Geiger that he is not welcome here. They've been told to kill him on sight. Geiger tells her to just take the kids. One of them is sick. This Nurse Red agrees to take them in. Geiger, he says his goodbye to the children, goodbye to Haley and Henry. He leaves them there in the care of these people. Geiger, he then returned home to his cabin near the bunker. He read his books. He took down the wall. He buried the bodies of his family that were skeletons all along. And then he waited until sunset, where the King finally arrived with the rest of his entire crew of nuclear knights. The King exclaimed, "We are here as requested, fool! Your head is mine!" And Geiger responds, "There's nothing here you can hurt. Not anymore." The text box reads, "Geiger opened his heart and found peace." The screen then goes bright yellow. Did Geiger metaphorically open his heart or literally open his heart? I'm not sure. Did he commit suicide? Did he self-destruct himself? I don't know. It's hard to know for sure, but it seems like his body exploded into this bright yellow light, and he killed everyone here, the King and all of his nuclear knights. And we see in the distance, Geiger's two-headed pet wolf is watching the explosion. We jump back to the characters from the beginning of the story, the Eye Patch Man and the other man. They comment that explosion with Geiger facing off against the King happened at this very spot. The man with the eye patch says, "The kids, Haley and Henry, they found help. That girl, she was someone special to me once." I think that this man with the eye patch might be that little kid Rick, now an old man. I could be wrong though. The Eye Patch Man continues and says, "But that was the end of the King. the end of Boulder City. The other man questions, and the end of Geiger? And the eye patch man answers, the end of Geiger himself? No, Geiger's story was only beginning. We see back in Las Vegas, shortly after the king died at the hands of Geiger. The various bosses of Las Vegas are having a meeting. Among them is the king's mother, known as the Queen, no longer looking as grotesque as she was earlier. The Queen says, Boulder City is gone, and so is my horrible son, the horrible scab. I beg you all for your forgiveness for his actions. They were unsanctioned by me, I assure you. Safari Bob, one of the other bosses we've heard a lot about, he replies, the king stirred the glowing man from his nest, dear queen. But perhaps that will benefit us all. The military wants Tariq Geiger, and we want the West. What do you say to that, General? And we see the general from the NORAD military base. The one with the scar on her cheek. She is standing there and she says, don't worry, Bob. I'm sure President Griffin is willing to make some kind of arrangement. How about we all discuss this over some pre-war whiskey? And that is the end of Volume 1. All right, so that was Volume 1 of Geiger, and I thought this was a very good Volume 1. The artwork by Gary Frank was beautiful, and I thought the overall story was pretty compelling. I love the world of Geiger, this post-apocalyptic world where you have this glowing, radiated man, and you have Vegas being ruled by these eccentric bosses. Very fun. I liked Geiger and his storyline in this volume, and his battle with this king, and Geiger hooking up with these kids and going on an adventure with them. That was all really fun, and I'm really curious to learn more about this world and some of these other characters that were teased, like Junkyard Joe and some of the others. But yeah, this was a really compelling Volume 1. Now, I wish it was maybe a little bit more self-contained and we had a little bit more answers. Like, is Geiger still alive? I'm not really quite sure on that. But nevertheless, this was a successful Volume 1. I want some more. I'm going to give this one an 8 out of 10. Let me know your thoughts in the comments, and thank you for watching. I'll be back next week with more comics.